Section 6 of Lancelot or the Knight of the Cart by Chrétien de Troyes. Verses 2615 to 3020. Not a word does he deign to reply to what he hears the other say, but the master of the house and all the others express their surprise openly. "Ah, God, what a misfortune this is!" each one of them says to himself. "Cursed be the hour when first a cart was conceived or made, for it is a very vile and hateful thing. Ah, God, of what was he accused? Why was he carried in a cart? For what sin or for what crime? He will always suffer the reproach, but if he were only clear of this disgrace, no knights could be found in all the world, however his valour might be proved, who would equal the merit of this knight. If all good knights could be compared, and if the truth were to be known, you could find none so handsome or so expert." Thus they expressed their sentiments. Then he began his speech of impudence. "Listen, thou knight who art bound for the sword bridge. If thou wishest, thou shalt cross the water very easily and comfortably. I will quickly have thee ferried over in a skiff. But once on the other side, I will make thee pay me toll, and I will take thy head if I please to do so. Or if not, thou shalt be held at my discretion." And he replies that he is not seeking trouble, and that he will never risk his head in such an adventure for any consideration. To which the other answers at once, "Since thou wilt not do this, whosoever the shame and loss may be, thou must come outside with me, and there engage me hand to hand." Then, to beguile him, the other says, "If I could refuse, I would very gladly excuse myself. But in truth, I would rather fight than be compelled to do what is wrong." Before he arose from the table where they were sitting, he told the youths who were serving him to saddle his horse at once, and fetch his arms and give them to him. This order they promptly execute. Some devote themselves to arming him, while others go to fetch his horse. As he slowly rode along, completely armed, holding his shield tight by the straps, you must know that he was evidently to be included in the list of the brave and fair. His horse became him so well that it is evident he must be his own, and as for the shield he held by the straps and the helmet laced upon his head, which fitted him so well, you would never for a moment have thought that he had borrowed it or received it as a loan. Rather, you would be so pleased with him that you would maintain that he had been thus born and raised. For all this, I should like you to take my word. Outside the gates, where the battle was to be fought, there was a stretch of level ground well adapted for the encounter. When they catch sight of each other, they spur hotly to the attack, and come together with such a shock, dealing such blows with their lances, that they first bend, then buckle up, and finally fly into splinters. With their swords they then hew away at their shields, helmets, and hauberks. The wood is cut, and the steel gives way, so that they wound each other in several places. They pay each other such angry blows that it seems as if they had made a bargain. The swords often descend upon the horses' croups, where they drink and feast upon their blood. Their riders strike them upon the flanks, until at last they kill them both. And when both have fallen to earth, they attack each other afoot, and if they had cherished a mortal hatred, they could not have assailed each other more fiercely with their swords. They deal their blows with greater frequency than the man who stakes his money at dice and never fails to double the stakes every time he loses. Yet this game of theirs was very different, for there were no losses here, but only fierce blows and cruel strife. All the people came out from the house, the master, his lady, his sons and daughters. No man or woman, friend or stranger, stayed behind, but all stood in line to see the fight in progress in the broad, level field. The knight of the cart blames and reproaches himself for faint-heartedness when he sees his host watching him and notices all the others looking on. His heart is stirred with anger, for it seems to him that he ought long since to have beaten his adversary. Then he strikes him, rushing in like a storm and bringing his sword down close by his head. He pushes and presses him so hard that he drives him from his ground and reduces him to such a state of exhaustion that he has little strength to defend himself. Then the knight recalls how the other had basely reproached him about the cart, so he assails him and drubs him so soundly that not a string or strap remains unbroken about the neckband of his hauberk. and he knocks the helmet and the ventail from his head. His wounds and distress are so great that he has to cry for mercy. Just as the lark cannot withstand or protect itself against the hawk which outflies it and attacks it from above, so he, in his helplessness and shame, must invoke him and sue for mercy. And when he hears him beg for mercy, he ceases his attack and says, "Dost thou wish for mercy?" He replies, "You have asked a very clever question. Any fool could ask that. I never wished for anything so much as I now wish for mercy." Then he says to him, "Thou must mount, then, upon a cart. Nothing thou couldst say would have any influence with me unless thou mountest the cart to atone for the vile reproaches thou didst address to me with thy silly mouth." And the knight answers him, "May it never please God that I mount a cart." "No," he asks, "then you shall die." "Sire, you can easily put me to death, but I beg and beseech you for God's sake to show me mercy and not compel me to mount a cart. I will agree to anything, however grievous, excepting that. I would rather die 100 times than undergo such a disgrace. In your goodness and mercy you can tell me nothing so distasteful that I would not do it." While he is thus beseeching him, behold across the field a maiden riding on a tawny mule, her head uncovered and her dress disarranged. In her hand she held a whip with which she belabored the mule, and in truth no horse could have galloped so fast as was the pace of the mule. The damsel called out to the knight of the cart, "May God bless thy heart, sir knight, with whatever delights thee most." And he, who heard her gladly, says, "May God bless you, damsel, and give you joy and health." Then she tells him of her desire. "Knight," she says, "in urgent need I have come from afar to ask thee a favour, for which thou wilt deserve the best guerdon I can make thee, and I believe that thou wilt yet have need of my assistance." And he replies, "Tell me what it is you wish, and if I have it, you shall have it at once, providing it be not something extravagant." Then she says, "It is the head of the knight whom thou hast just defeated. In truth, thou hast never dealt with such a wicked and faithless man. Thou wilt be committing no sin or wrong, but rather doing a deed of charity, for he is the basest creature that ever was or ever shall be." And when he who had been vanquished hears that she wishes him to be killed, he says to him, "Don't believe her, for she hates me. But by that God who was at once father and son, and who chose for his mother her who was his daughter and handmaiden, I beg you to have mercy upon me." "Ah, knight," the maiden exclaims, "pay no attention to what this traitor says. May God give thee all the joy and honour to which thou dost aspire, and may he give thee good success in thy undertaking." Then the knight is in a predicament, as he thinks and ponders over the question, whether to present to her the head she asks him to cut off, or whether he should allow himself to be touched by pity for him. He wishes to respect the wishes of both her and him. Generosity and pity each command him to do their will, for he was both generous and tender-hearted. But if she carries off the head, then will pity be defeated and put to death, whereas if she does not carry off the head, generosity will be discomfited. Thus pity and generosity holds him so confined and so distressed that he is tormented and spurred on by each of them in turn. The damsel asks him to give her the head, and on the other hand the knight makes his request, appealing to his pity and kindness. And since he has implored him, shall he not receive mercy? Yes, for it never happened that, when he had put down an enemy and compelled him to sue for mercy, he would refuse such an one his mercy, or longer bear him any grudge. Since this is his custom, he would not refuse his mercy to him who now begs for it. And shall she have the head she covets? Yes, if it be possible. Knight, he says, it is necessary for thee to fight me again, and if thou dost care to defend thy head again, I will show thee such mercy as to allow thee to resume the helmet, and I will give thee time to arm thy body and thy head as well as possible. But if I conquer thee again, know that thou shalt surely die. And he replies, I desire nothing better than that, and ask for no further favour. And I will give thee this advantage, he adds, I will fight thee as I stand, without changing my present position. Then the other knight makes ready, and they begin the fight again eagerly. But this time the knight triumphed more quickly than he had done at first, and the damsel at once cries out, Do not spare him, knight, for anything he may say to thee. Surely he would not have spared thee had he once defeated thee. If thou heedest what he says, be sure he will again beguile thee. Fair knight, cut off the head of the most faithless man in the empire and kingdom, and give it to me. Thou shouldest present it to me in view of the guerdon I intend for thee. For another day may well come when, if he can, he will beguile thee again with his words. He, thinking his end is near, cries aloud to him for mercy. But his cry is of no avail, nor anything that he can say. The other drags him by the helmet, tearing all the fastening, and he strikes from his head the ventail and the gleaming coif. Then he cries out more loudly still, "Mercy, for God's sake, mercy, sir!" But the other answers, "So help me, I shall never again show thee pity, after having once let thee off." "Ah," he says, "thou wouldst do no wrong to heed my enemy and kill me thus." While she, intent upon his death, admonishes him to cut off his head, and not believe a word he says. He strikes. The head flies across the sword, and the body fails. Then the damsel is pleased and satisfied. Grasping the head by the hair, the knight presents it to the damsel, who takes it joyfully with the words, "May thy heart receive such delight from whatever it most desires as my heart now receives from what I most coveted. I had only one grief in life, and that was that this man was still alive, and I have a reward laid up for thee which thou shalt receive at the proper time. I promise thee that thou shalt have a worthy reward for the service thou hast rendered me. Now I will go away, with the prayer that God may guard thee from harm." Then the damsel leaves him, as each commends the other to God. But all those who had seen the battle in the plain are overjoyed, and in their joy they at once relieve the knight of his armor and honor him in every way they can. Then they wash their hands again and take their places at the meal, which they eat with better cheer than is their wont. When they had been eating for some time, the gentleman turned to his guest at his side and said, "Sire, a long while ago we came hither from the kingdom of Logra. We were born your countrymen, and we should like to see you win honor and fortune and joy in this country. For we should profit by it as well as you, and it should be to the advantage of many others if you should gain honor and fortune in the enterprise you have undertaken in this land." And he makes answer, "May God hear your desire." When the host had dropped his voice and ceased speaking, one of his sons followed him and said, "Sire, we ought to place all our resources at your service, and give them outright rather than promise them. If you have any need of our assistance, we ought not to wait until you ask for it. Sire, be not concerned over your horse which is dead. We have good strong horses here. I want you to take anything of ours which you need, and you shall choose the best of our horses in place of yours." And he replies, "I willingly accept." Thereupon they have the beds prepared and retire for the night. The next morning they rise early and dress, after which they prepare to start. Upon leaving they fail in no act of courtesy, but take leave of the lady, her lord, and all the rest. But in order to omit nothing, I must remark that the knight was unwilling to mount the borrowed steed which was standing ready at the door. Rather, he caused him to be ridden by one of the two knights who had come with him, while he took the latter's horse instead, for thus it pleased him best to do. When each was seated on his horse, they all asked for leave to depart from their host who had served them so honorably. Then they ride along the road until the day draws to a close, and late in the afternoon they reach the Sword Bridge. End of section 6.